I think we're looking at something much worse than an economic collapse. I think we're looking at a societal change, a societal shift, maybe even a societal collapse. Hey guys, welcome back to the Dimcat channel. I'm Reginald, also known as Dimcat. First, thank you guys for all your well wishes. As most of you guys know, my mother passed away. I did a video, and I'd like to thank you guys for your positive energy. Thank you so much. But I want to talk about the news. I want to talk about current events, things that I've been witnessing, not just news articles, things that I've seen with my own eyes. You know, it's one thing to read about it. It's another thing to actually see it. Societal. This country is so divided at this point. I don't know. I don't see how the country can move forward and be functional. At least I don't see how we can have functional leadership. And maybe that's part of the plan. Maybe that's why we're being attacked from within. I want to talk about some resources you guys might want to consider. J.R. Nyquist. This guy, when it comes to geopolitics, he's really amazing. He's been talking about how the Cold War is not what we really thought it was. At least the ending wasn't. He's basically talking about what's going on in our country right now. The forces are working against American people. He's basically convinced that both Russia and China are working or playing the left and right against one another, trying to divide this country, and ultimately they're trying to turn us against one another so that they can actually move in and take a lot of our resources. And if you think that's a bit extreme, look at what's going on in Africa. China's been consuming a great deal of their resources, buying up a lot of resources, even Australia. But, you know, he's a really interesting person to look at, a different perspective. I'll put some links below for his interview. He did an interview on with the Health Ranger. It was on the Health Ranger Report, so I'm going to put a link on there so you guys can check that interview out. He actually did a couple of them. They're really good. This other guy, he is a he's an ATF whistleblower. He is a he was a DEA agent. He was an intelligence officer, and now he's really covering what's been going on with our government, what's been going on with the Arizona audits, the fight between, you know, the Patriots and the Marxists that want to transform this country. His name is Jeffrey Prather. Yeah, his name is J-E-F-F-R-E-Y, Prather. I'll put a link below. I'll put a little description as well. He's really fascinating. Another person, the Health Ranger himself, Mike Adams. He's a bit wacky at times, but he's got an interesting perspective on what he thinks what's heading our way. I don't know what exactly is going our way. I don't know if it's going to be a stage event so the government can use to sort of target our rights. Right to own guns or whatever. I don't know what it is. I don't know if we're going to have a serious problem with the vaccine, which is something that Cliff High talks about. Cliff High is this guy who uses computers and computer systems to gather data from the internet. They sort of get what's on people's minds, and really try to, the whole idea is that people intuitively know what's coming ahead, and if he gathers enough information, he sends these web bots out, and if they grab enough information, he can sort of have an idea of what's coming, because people sort of, the crowd sort of has an idea, even subliminally. He can explain it better, but he's really interesting. He's been talking about the vaccination. Speaking of which, vaccine situation, San Francisco, they're saying that all 30,000 of their employees are going to have to get the vaccine once the FDA finally approves this vaccine. If you want to call it a vaccine or gene therapy, it's a mRNA vaccine, whatever you want to call it. What's interesting is that Johnson & Johnson has some problems with the young men actually developing heart conditions. I actually ran into somebody when I was in Flint, a friend. I learned that this is one gentleman, young, in his 20s, who got the vaccine, and 2 weeks later, he lost his life. I'm not making any claims or anything. I'm just saying this is what I was told. They said he was a healthy guy. Now I was at a gas station in Ohio. This lady was telling me about how her family, they got really, really sick as soon as they had the vaccine. Again, I'm not pretending to have any medical knowledge. I'm just saying there's different perspectives out there, and I think some of them are worth listening to, or at least considering. Cliff High, when it comes to that vaccine stuff. I'm running into people, so it's kind of hard for me to ignore the reality that's really going on. San Francisco saying that, hey, we're going to require people to have this vaccine. Here's the thing. Vaccines take a really long time to get approved. Like, any drug really takes a very... It takes years for drugs to get approved by the FDA. This whole Project Warp Speed is an anomaly. This is something that hasn't been done before. And okay, China. Well, the whole vaccine situation, the whole COVID situation, at this point, it's pretty obvious there's enough evidence to lead enough people to believe, to know that this is not a naturally occurring virus. There's no ancestor to this virus. It's like, okay, you have a mother, father, grandfather, grandmother, you know, great grandparents, so on, right? You didn't just pop up here. Well, the only way you can just pop up here is unless you were artificial. Well, viruses don't just pop up. They have to come from something that they are naturally occurring. Well, that's just not happening here. And I'm still frustrated when I read out that report about how scientists from Harvard and MIT, they knew that this lab leak theory was valid, but they didn't want to say anything because they didn't want to seem like they were backing up Trump. And when I hear that, I'm thinking, okay, so we're at a point where these people aren't even willing to do their jobs. They're more interested in politics and actually helping people with science. You know, this is why people don't just trust the science, because it's not always just about the science. It's about an agenda. That's what it's about, an agenda behind their so-called science. And then the science is, real hard science is often ignored because there's a certain agenda. Now, I don't know what's the end game with this vaccine. I personally chose not to go with it. I hope things aren't as dire as some people are making them out to be. I really do. I want good things for people. I really do. But I am concerned. I am concerned about why so many people in this country, certain people in leadership, are so desperate to get people to have this vaccine. Why? You know, people, of course, are talking about, somebody could have mentioned Agenda 21 or something like that, but I'm not claiming to have the answers, but I do want to know. I want to know why. Some other news stories worth mentioning, John McAfee, the virus software guy, he did other things as well. He was very outspoken, to say the least. He died in jail in Europe. His lawyers, apparently it was a suicide, but his lawyers are saying, no, it was not a suicide. He didn't just end his life, okay? He was going to be extradited to the U.S., but, you know, he obviously didn't make it that far. These are some of the things that are going on right now. It is frustrating. It's frustrating because you realize that, okay, the scientific community, they don't have our best interests at heart. And when I say our, the American people, but they don't have our best interests at heart. Big tech controlling our communication, they don't have our best interests at heart. The mainstream media, they don't have our best interests at heart. I mean, you know, I feel boxed in here. Maybe it's just me, but I know I'm not the only one. No, I'm not the only one who really feels this way. And the whole Arizona audit situation, we'll see what happens there with that situation. In a normal race, if they had fraud or anything like that, then they would just say, okay, we're going to make the correction right here and there. But when it comes to the presidency, speaking of the presidency, okay, Joe Biden, he came out and said that, well, you know, he was attacking gun rights, saying that guns basically aren't effective because you can't really stand up to a tyrannical government. You can't take on the government unless you have F-15s and nukes, which is an old argument people have been using for a long time. And it's something people would believe if they never picked up a history book, never read anything. I mean, if you needed nukes and an F-15 to win a war, I mean, a lot of revolutions would have never happened, okay? All right. The American Revolution, at times, the Americans were outgunned, okay? They were revolutionaries. They didn't have the best tech, not even close. This is that argument of, oh, guns aren't going to protect you from a tyrannical government, therefore you should turn them over. You know, that's the argument. So basically, I should turn over what little leverage I have. You're claiming it's not a lot of leverage. Okay, and now you're arguing that I should turn it over. Does that seem logical? Okay, it's so like, okay, you're in a auditorium, and there's a madman with an AK-47 threatening everybody, saying, "Do what I say. I'm the government. Do what I say, or else." Now, of course, I'm not saying everybody works for the government is a lunatic with an AK-47. I'm just saying under this scenario, if you had a tyrannical government, you can say that this lunatic in an auditorium is the guy with the AK-47 saying, "I'm the government. Do as I say." He got 100 scared people there, and maybe only 10 of them have handguns. Well, yeah, AK-47 is better than a handgun. Any rifle is pretty much better than a handgun. But the fact of the matter is, 10 people with a handgun, they're probably going to be in a decent shape when it comes to one person with an AK-47, you know. But the whole argument there is, okay, well, there's no point in having those handguns because I've got an AK-47, or we've got a drone, we got tanks, and we got this. Therefore, you should give up whatever you have to defend yourself. Okay, so you think a tyrannical government will just take it easy on you once you give up what little means you have of protecting yourself? I mean, it's ridiculous. Just look at all these wars where there were revolutions and there were asymmetric warfare. But anyway, I'm not going to get into all that. The Second Amendment, I think I know there's a record amount of black people buying guns, record amount of women who bought guns last year. You can find the articles. It's pretty obvious. Asian Americans, Latinos, a significant amount of people bought guns, and they weren't just white Christian males. It's a lot of different people. So what I think is, this is going to lead to something that's really good for the Second Amendment long term. The Democratic Party, they're not going to be able to really push. They're going to keep trying it because you have these white liberal elites, but then you also have blacks and but the white working class elite, they're going to be they're very disconnected from what everybody else is going to want as far as gun control and gun rights. I think I see good things happening on the horizon. It's a Supreme Court, who knows? You guys know I lost faith in them a long time ago, but there's been some signs of life, some signs that they're willing to do their job. And they can still redeem themselves if they look at the evidence in Arizona, if they look at the evidence. There's talk of having an audit in Pennsylvania. They're pushing towards that. Michigan's going to be more of a struggle, but we'll see what happens there. So we're seeing a transformation, okay? We're at a point where we have so much debt that the country just simply isn't going to be able to pay it back. That's going to lead to a disaster. May not be tomorrow, may not be next year, but I think it's going to be relatively soon, because even the Russians recently announced that they're trying to get out the U.S. dollar. So should you invest in cryptocurrencies, or I don't know. I don't know anything about that stuff. I do know this. You better make sure you have extra food, extra non-perishable food, plenty of water for you and everybody in your house for at least 30 days. At least 30 days, okay? Before you go out and buy another big screen TV, before you do anything else, make sure you have that. For another, at least basic food and water, a means of cooking the food if you have to, canned goods or freeze-dried foods, whatever works for you. I'm gonna start talking about the basics as far as prepping. So anyway, JR Nyquist, worth looking at. Cliff High, if you're looking, you wanna really try something different, a really different perspective on vaccines. And thank you guys for your support. Thank you guys for taking the time to watch my videos. Thank you for just watching. You know, some of you guys have been watching since I lived in Alaska, since I lived in Michigan the first time. And, not the first time. I started my video in Alaska, so the second time. So thank you guys so much. I actually ran across a guy on the street recently. I was walking downtown. He was like, "Hey, Doomcat." And it's always cool when I run into people who watch my channel. The support is just wonderful, and I hope you guys invest in your families by preparing. Speaking of preparing, I'm not getting any money to promote this, but this is the ultimate prepper's survival guide, okay? If you're interested in prepping and you just wanna sort of get an idea of what's really going on, you can definitely watch this channel, of course. There's other channels as well, but this book right here, it has tabs, dangers, mentality, essentials, protection, community, the checklist. I love the checklist. I love the whole concept where you just look at, okay, what are my vulnerabilities? If I had to go from point A to point B, what should I do? The year after is a chapter 11 called A Year After, chapter 12, list of lists, books, bug out bag, food, water, financial preparation. At the very least, if you're in a city, food and water. Okay, so definitely consider things like this. Oh, oldie but a goodie. SAS Survival Guide. If you're looking for a nice compact book with a lot of good information, this is awesome. It's a section on food, climate and terrain, essentials. So this is something you can just actually put inside of your bug out bag. It's called SAS Survival Guide, revised version. They probably have a revised version. This is by Collins. I never really looked at the author, but this is an awesome book I had for years. So again, food, I don't care what type of freeze-dried food you get. If you do go with something like a freeze-dried, make sure you get a sample first before you just go all in. So I'm gonna buy a whole bunch of it, you know, if you care about stuff like that, taste. So, and you know, you use containers. You can find this at a Walmart container for water, or I recommend just getting bottled waters. I know it's not the best thing for the environment, but in a pinch, you're gonna want water. You do not want to go out in the chaos, risking your life, because you didn't take time to at least buy some water. Having 30 days of water means that you can sit in your house, take care of your family, and let things blow over. So, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today.